One day, in the middle of winter, when the snowflakes fell from the sky like feathers, a queen sat at a window netting. Her netting needle was of black ebony, and as she worked and the snow glittered, she pricked her finger, and three drops of blood fell into the snow. The red spots looked so beautiful in the white snow that the queen thought to herself, "Oh, if I only had a little child, I should like it to be as fair as snow, as rosy as the red blood, and with hair and eyes as black as ebony." Very soon after this, the queen had a little daughter who was very fair, had rosy cheeks and hair as black as ebony, and they gave her the name of Snow White. But at the birth of the little child, the queen died. When Snow White was a year old, the king took another wife. She was very handsome, but so proud and vain that she could not endure that anyone should surpass her in beauty. She possessed a wonderful mirror, and when she stood before it to look at herself, she would say, "Mirror, mirror, on the wall, am I most beautiful of all?" Then the mirror would reply, "Young queen, thou art so wondrous fair, none can with thee at all compare." Then she would go away quite contented, for she knew the magic mirror could speak only the truth. Years went by, and as Snow White grew up, she became day after day more beautiful, till she reached the age of 7 years, and then people began to talk about her, and say that she would be more lovely even than the queen herself. So the proud woman went to her magic looking-glass and asked, "Mirror, mirror, on the wall, am I most beautiful of all?" But the mirror answered, "Queen, thou art lovely still to see, but Snow White will be 1,000 times more beautiful than thee." Then the queen was terrified, and turned green and yellow with jealousy. If she had caught sight of Snow White at that moment, she would have been ready to tear her heart out of her body. She hated the maiden so fiercely. And this jealousy and envy grew every day stronger and stronger in her heart, like a disease, till she had no rest day or night. At last she sent for a hunter, who lived near a forest, and said to him, "Hunter, I want to get rid of that child. Take her out into the wood, and if you bring me some proofs that she is dead, I will reward you handsomely. Never let her appear before my eyes again." So the hunter enticed the child into the wood. But when he took out his hunting knife to thrust it into Snow White's innocent heart, she fell on her knees and wept, and said, "Oh, dear hunter, leave me my life. I will run away into the wild wood and never, never come home any more." She looked so innocent and beautiful as she knelt that the hunter's heart was moved with compassion. "Run away, then, thou poor child," he cried. "I cannot harm thee." Snow White thanked him so sweetly and was out of sight in a few moments. "She will be devoured by wild beasts," he said to himself, but the thought that he had not killed her was as if a stone weight had been lifted from his heart. To satisfy the queen, he took part of the inside of a young fawn, which the wicked woman thought was poor little Snow White, and was overjoyed to think she was dead. But the poor little motherless child, when she found herself alone in the wood and saw nothing but trees and leaves, was dreadfully frightened and knew not what to do. At last she began to run over the sharp stones and through the thorns, and though the wild beasts sprang out before her, they did her no harm. She ran on as long as she could, till her little feet became quite sore, and towards evening she saw, to her great joy, a pretty little house, so she went up to it and found the door open and no one at home. It was a tiny little house, but everything in it was so clean and neat and elegant that it is beyond description. In the middle of the room stood a small table, covered with a snow-white tablecloth, ready for supper. On it were arranged 7 little plates, 7 little spoons, 7 little knives and forks, and 7 mugs. By the wall stood 7 little beds near each other, covered with white quilts. Poor Snow White, who was hungry and thirsty, ate a few vegetables and a little bread from each plate, and drank a little drop of wine from each cup, for she did not like to take all she wanted from one alone. After this, feeling very tired, she thought that she would lie down and rest on one of the beds, but she found it difficult to choose one to suit her. One was too long, another too short, so she tried them all till she came to the 7th, and that was so comfortable that she laid herself down and was soon fast asleep. When it was quite dark, the masters of the house came home. They were 7 little dwarfs who dug and searched in the mountains for minerals. First they lighted 7 little lamps, and as soon as the room was full of light, they saw that someone had been there, for everything did not stand in the order in which they had left it. Then said the first, "Who has been sitting in my little chair?" The second exclaimed, "Who has been eating from my little plate?" The third cried, "Someone has taken part of my bread."
"Who has been eating my vegetables?" said the fourth.
Then said the fifth, "Someone has used my fork." The sixth cried, "And who has been cutting with my knife?"
"And someone has been drinking out of my cup," said the seventh.
Then the eldest looked at his bed, and seeing that it looked tumbled, cried out that someone had been upon it. The others came running forward and found all their beds in the same condition. But when the seventh approached his bed and saw Snow White lying there fast asleep, he called the others, who came quickly, and holding their lights over their heads, cried out in wonder as they beheld the sleeping child.
"Oh, what a beautiful little child!"
they said to each other, and were so delighted that they would not awaken her, but left her to sleep as long as she liked in the little bed, while its owner slept with one of his companions, and so the night passed away. In the morning, when Snow White awoke and saw all the dwarfs, she was terribly frightened, but they spoke kindly to her till she lost all fear, and they asked her name.
"I am called Snow White," she replied.
"But how came you to our house?" asked one.
Then she related to them all that had happened, how her stepmother had sent her into the wood with the hunter, who had spared her life, and that, after wandering about for a whole day, she had found their house. The dwarfs talked a little while together, and then one said,
"Do you think you could be our little housekeeper, to make the beds, cook the dinner, and wash and sew and knit for us, and keep everything neat and clean and orderly? If you can, then you shall stay here with us, and nobody shall hurt you."
"Oh, yes, I will try," said Snow White. So they let her stay, and she was a clever little thing. She managed very well, and kept the house quite clean and in order.
And while they were gone to the mountains to find gold, she got their supper ready, and they were very happy together. But every morning when they left her, the kind little dwarfs warned Snow White to be careful. While the maiden was alone, they knew she was in danger, and told her not to show herself, for her stepmother would soon find out where she was, and said,
"Whatever you do, let nobody into the house while we are gone."
After the wicked queen had proved, as she thought, that Snow White was dead, she felt quite satisfied there was no one in the world now likely to become so beautiful as herself. So she stepped up to her mirror and asked,
"Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is most beautiful of all?"
To her vexation, the mirror replied,
"Fair queen, at home there is none like thee, but over the mountains is Snow White free, with 7 little dwarfs who are strange to see. 1,000 times fairer than thou is she."
The queen was furious when she heard this, for she knew the mirror was truthful, and that the hunter must have deceived her, and that Snow White still lived. So she sat and pondered over these facts, thinking what would be best to do. For as long as she was not the most beautiful woman in the land, her jealousy gave her no peace. After a time she decided what to do. First she painted her face and whitened her hair. Then she dressed herself in old woman's clothes, and was so disguised that no one could have recognized her. Watching an opportunity, she left the castle and took her way to the wood near the mountains, where the seven little dwarfs lived. When she reached the door, she knocked and cried,
"Beautiful goods to sell! Beautiful goods to sell!"
Snow White, when she heard it, peeped through the window and said, "Good day, old lady. What have you in your basket for me to buy?"
"Everything that is pretty," she replied. "Laces and pearls and earrings and bracelets of every color."
And she held up her basket, which was lined with glittering silk. "I can let in this respectable old woman," thought Snow White. "She will not harm me." So she unbolted the door and told her to come in. Oh, how delighted Snow White was with the pretty things! She bought several trinkets and a beautiful silk lace for her stays, but she did not see the evil eye of the old woman who was watching her. Presently she said,
"Child, come here. I will show you how to lace your stays properly."
Snow White had no suspicion, so she placed herself before the old woman that she might lace her stays. But no sooner was the lace in the holes than she began to lace so fast and pull so tight that Snow White could not breathe, and presently fell down at her feet as if dead.
"Now you are beautiful indeed," said the woman, and fancying she heard footsteps, she rushed away as quickly as she could.
Not long after, the seven dwarfs came home, and they were terribly frightened.